r/AskReddit. Cult survivors of Reddit, what is your story? I wish I knew his whole story. But I met a patient who was one of the few survivors of the Jonestown massacre. He had gotten out a few days before the mass suicide. But sadly he was unable to get his wife and child out. You could tell, and I am sure it would be the same for anyone, that he had carried some serious guilt the rest of his life. Unfortunately he passed recently. Jonestown Massacre. Now that's truly dark. Sorry to hear his wife and child couldn't get out. That's an absolute nightmare. I once heard an audio recording from the Jonestown Massacre. One thing I remember from that is hearing a child scream, "I don't wanna. I don't wanna." Chilling. My aunt, never met her, is part of a cult in Texas. A couple of my cousins, her daughters, got out and were basically shunned by the community. My aunt told my cousin that she would go to her wedding, and then before the wedding she sent a letter to my cousin that she wasn't going anymore because the marriage was damned to hell. She also told her sister, my other aunt, that she got sick, had cancer, because she didn't believe enough. My cousins are very successful now and work hard, but damn. They went through some crazy brainwashing as kids. What kind of brainwashing? With Tide. Of course. I've never been in a cult. But my mom was abandoned at a cult when she was 11 with her 16-year-old and 7-year-old sisters. My grandmother was mentally ill and somehow got connected with these people in Iowa. They were from the deep south. Anyway. My grandmother didn't stay. No one knows where she went during that time. My mom and her two sisters were left there for around 6 months until my mom got to a phone and called her stepfather. He somehow arranged to pick them up with the local law enforcement. He wasn't allowed to just walk right up and get his kids. So he showed up in the middle of the night and mom and her sisters had to hide and sneak away with him. Law enforcement hung around and gave them an escort out of the state. I think that the worst part for my mom and her sisters was not only were they abandoned by their mother, but they were never allowed to confront her with it per her psychiatrist. She was a pretty hitty mother and an absent grandmother to us grandchildren. Your poor mom. Yeah. She's recently talked about it a little more because both of those sisters have passed away in the last couple of years and my grandmother died about 10 years ago. I guess she feels like she can let go of that experience maybe. I grew up in the, redacted because it comes up in Google searches, cult. I wasn't born into it, my family converted when I was 9-ish. I remember everything about my life changed. We went from a seemingly normal family with no religion to suddenly everything was a sin. Everything was wrong. The Prophet WMB was born in 1909 and died in 1965. To this day, there are people who still believe he is going to magically come back to life and preach tent meetings around the world. List of various cult rules. I left the cult and my family the night before I turned 18 with the help of my now ex-husband. Another story for another day. My family finally realized about 2 years ago that they were brainwashed and left the cult. They're still trying to find what normal is for them. Many things have gone back to the way they were before they converted, music selection, etc. In that environment, women are a doormat. We have to be submissive to our husbands in every way. Women are supposed to stay home and basically be child dispensers. I knew from a young age that I was child free. So this never appealed to me. While I enjoy doing all of the wifely things, cooking, cleaning, etc., I knew that there was more for me. I am now 27 and a successful businesswoman. Sometimes I do still struggle with the cult mentality. Some of those things never leave you. It wasn't until recently that I thought of myself and my partners as equals, two people on the same team working towards the same goals. Funny thing is that my previous pastor, Daniel Jacendina, was actually arrested for DUI last year. It's hilarious and awesome, but also sad to hear about all of the corruption in the church and cult. I can't understand how so many otherwise intelligent people can be so brainwashed. Edit if you wish to find more info. Google. Redacted because this comment it comes up in Google searches. I like how the rules vary from obnoxious, but relatively standard in religious groups like no premarital relations and no revealing clothes to that is the most bizarre thing I've ever heard, like no naming your kid Ricky. No loving dogs, is having one okay as long as your opinion of it remains neutral? No soup suppers, is it okay to have soup for breakfast? As a side dish. And no living in valleys. By the time my family joined in the 90s, some of these rules were no longer followed. So they weren't quoted in sermons. This includes soup suppers and loving dogs. I'll have to find actual quotes on these to find out their origin. You're not supposed to name your son Ricky because he said the name Ricky means rat and your son would grow up to be a scoundrel. I was raised in the Family Radio Fellowship. It has had ties to the Quiverful movement and carries an apocalyptic message. For those of you lucky enough to not know, Family Radio is an evangelical Christian sect that has predicted the end of the world a couple of times. Family Radio didn't gain a lot of traction until about a month before its last prediction of the 21st of May, 2011. However, I was born and raised in the movement, and was completely absorbed. Everything, and I mean everything, in my life was to lead up to that day. It was considered a sin to consider living after the rapture. So we weren't allowed to make long-term plans. As a young person, this usually meant dropping out of high school or not going to college. Yep. Kept us dumb enough to keep following them. I gave Family Radio and their sister organization E-Bible Fellowship, which is still going strong, all of my money. I gave them my life. When the world didn't end, I got two jobs. Put myself through community college. And am now almost done with university. I am pretty rare. Most young people never got to earn an education. Many of the families sold their houses as they planned to go on road trips to spread the word. Plenty of families ended up with nothing. Homeless and jobless. Some people were separated from their families. One woman joined the movement. And her husband realized how crazy it all was. He took their kid and vanished. I don't know if she ever found them after the prophecy failed. There is a lot of crazy hit. And a lot of sad stories. Sometimes, I still have nightmares about it. It was abuse. Plain and simple, although I've worked hard to move past it and built a life. I just ask that you empathize with cult followers. I know. How the duck can I ask you to do that? I feel like I have a unique viewpoint. Because I know what it's like to be sucked into a cult and now I know what it's like to watch cult followers from the other side. There were assholes in our movement. But we also had individuals who were genuinely lost and looking for a community. People who really thought they were doing good. Were they? Hell no. But they were brainwashed. It's just sad. How did you and your family react when the end didn't come? Me and my buddy were just talking about this tonight. For some reason it came up. We were together that day on vacation with my family and sitting outside watching this big ass cloud coming from out over the ocean. Understandably, we kinda got nervous. Then the cloud kinda broke up and it got really nice out. Then he looks up from his phone and says, "Wow. It says here that M. Bone was killed." Yes. That's right. He dougied his way into heaven. I worked for a New York City political party which doubled as a sex cult behind the scenes. Here is an article about them. Here's another. The short version is that they're a political party whose foundation is built on a controversial form of amateur therapy which insisted that depressed lost people use political activism as their means of finding fulfillment. It's a perpetual motion device essentially. Processing sad people into activists for the cause via a school and political party both headed by the same figure. Lots of sketchy additional hit about patient-patient and patient-doctor sex being a part of therapy. And the highly questionable practice of party members and patients giving financial donations to support the party leader's lifestyle. I worked for the party for a while. And definitely felt like they were trying to convert me in a number of instances. Please PM me, I need help taking down a corrupt judge in Albany appointed by the Independence Party. Please, any information would help. This man is a drunken driver who protects pedophiles. He recently ordered a girl to have visits with the father that was convicted of raping her. I need help protecting my wife's, child. Please, any info or where to dig, please. Anthony Weiner should join. My best friend is part of the Jesus Army in Britain. I don't know a lot about other Jesus Army groups throughout the UK, but this particular one forced her to drop out of college. She is extremely clever and wanted to be a nurse and come and work for their church. An office job of some sort. So she dropped out, moved into their large community home, and I visited a lot. She didn't get her wages, they were pulled into a communal pot sort of thing. And she had to ask for her money from the head of the household to go buy things. But only things the Jesus Army permitted, like modest clothing or ingredients for the cooking. It was automatically assumed if you were a female and lived with these people. You cook meals for 20 plus people every night, but you can't sit at the same table as the men. And you aren't allowed seconds, but the men were. But say if she wanted to go buy a chocolate bar, this wouldn't be allowed. Anyway. It was just a really extreme sexist, outdated sort of living. Like, she wouldn't be allowed to pursue a partner unless she told the head of the Jesus Army, and then they would set them on a date. And if they got on, they would have to spend a year apart to pray about each other. And if they still liked each other after a year of no contact, they can marry. Anyway, the whole ordeal stressed her out, and now she's in hospital because she has developed anorexia. Her food being the only thing she feels she can control. She doesn't live at the community home anymore. Which I see as a good thing. Lots of other shady stuff went on, but those were the things that made me the most angry. She is still pretty deluded about all of this. I used to live in Northampton, and there was a rather large Jesus Army building right in the town center. And I'd often see vans. I had no idea what they were. This is quite chilling. Wasn't a survivor or anything, but my sister and I grew up in a town which was the base of a local cult. She became best friends with one of the members' daughters. She told me she went to a meeting once and everyone was kissing the guy's ring's hand, and that he gave her a really weird vibe. She was only 7-8 at this time. Turns out her best friend's family, the father, was actually working undercover for a few years and scoping the place out, and it was kinda busted up before anything serious happened. Here's a quick link. The cult was small and focused mostly in fraud, but was mainly busted due to molestation charges. Culteducation.com link. It's kind of interesting to hear about a Christian cult that doesn't come from the US's deep south. And how it takes the same character as many of those cults despite the cultural differences between people in the US South and Koreans. I lived in a sizable apartment as a student with one other student and a family. Who owned the place? They were originally not from my country, the Netherlands. But while definitely also not Asian. The walls of their part of the house were plastered with images of Asian people. I initially couldn't figure out why. But never really dared to ask, and we really only shared the front door. After my dad died, they sent my family the weirdest religious letter I had ever read and invited me for an evening with their church. By then, my interest was piqued. I'm not religious, and clearly this was going to be fascinating. The church was a row house like any other, but there were plenty of people my age. Clearly, this wasn't just a mass. They had brought young people to lure the new guest, me, into it. I played along for as long as I felt comfortable, and then someone mentioned Reverend Moon. Holy hit. Moon. They are Moonies. I moved out not long after. For other reasons. And never heard from them again. It was my one memorable night with a cult. This will probably get buried, but my father was born into a cult in Turkey. This cult essentially believed that this certain guy was a descendant of Muhammad and that they had to obey his word as law or something. The man owned an engineering company, and my father has always wanted to be an engineer his entire life. It was expected that he was going to work in the company. My dad was also close friends with the leader's son. Which made my grandparents really happy. I'd like to point out that nothing illegal like fraud or child molestation happened in this cult. It was just a community of people who believed that this man was a descendant of Muhammad and that his word was law. My dad said that many of the people in the cult weren't bad or evil. They just really needed someone to make their choices for them. However, leaving this cult was horrible for my dad. Even though it wasn't a violent cult, my dad realized that he didn't want to work in the guy's factory and didn't want to marry someone from the cult. So he actually went abroad to study in Austria for his master's in engineering so that he could escape the cult. When he finished his master's, he went back to Austria to finish his doctorate because he couldn't take living within the cult. Eventually, he went so far to escape that after he was done with education, he went to San Francisco to learn English. Just so that he could avoid being in the cult. My mom found out that my dad was in a cult after they were married. She found out while she was cleaning the house, and she found some papers in my dad's office that had written on them, "I'm not a sinner. I'm not going to heal because I left the cult. I don't believe in the cult, etc. Leaving the cult left my dad in a state of depression, and it shows how strong he was to be able to leave. Some good came out of it because my dad ended up getting a PhD in engineering, and also my brother and I weren't raised religiously, and my dad always wanted us to make our own choices in what we believe in. I just want to leave people with the message that a cult doesn't have to be violent to be dangerous, and that many normal people can become victims of a cult. My dad said that the people in the cult were very nice. Normal people. They just needed someone to make their decisions for them. This phenomenon is explained by psychology. However, even though the cult disbanded and it's been over 20 years since my dad left, it's still something that can never leave him. She found out while she was cleaning the house, and she found some papers in my dad's office that had written on them, "I'm not a sinner. I'm not going to heal because I left the cult. I don't believe in the cult, etc." That would be pretty terrifying for your mom to find that. Like The Shining or something. This may be an unpopular opinion, but the deaf culture is a cult that worships deafness. They attack any deaf person who tries to learn speech and interacts with hearing people. I was born deaf and raised in the deaf community. Thankfully, my parents sent me to a speech therapist and I can speak pretty well. When I was a teenager, I started to realize how messed up and self-destructive the deaf culture was, and I left. I went to a regular college, not a deaf-oriented college like Gallaudet, and landed a great job. I have only a few deaf friends, but they have the same mindset as mine. I left the cult of deafness 10 plus years ago and I'm still paying the price. I still have deaf people harassing me on Facebook, calling me a traitor and hearing-minded. I could go on and on about how much of a messed up cult the deaf culture is. But I'll just paste what my deaf friend wrote in an email. I feel that it accurately describes the deaf community and why it's so ducked up. The deaf community is significant other gung-ho on their deaf pride bullet that they've held us back a few decades. When you think about it, blind people don't have blind pride. Amputees don't open amputee schools. And people with other diseases or disabilities don't refuse any kind of treatment in order to preserve their disease or disability the way deaf people do. A few years ago, I met a woman who was born 100% blind. She had surgery when she was a teenager, in the 90s or early zeros, I believe, and now she has near perfect eyesight. And look at the technology we've come up with for amputees. We come up with amazing stuff all the time. Yet we deaf people are stuck with technology from the 80s, hearing aids and cochlear implants, because the deaf community is so adamant on preserving their deafness and the community that they refuse any kind of treatment or cure that will help them hear. This pisses me off so much. If it weren't for those idiots rallying around deaf pride, they'd probably have already come up with a cure and I'd be able to hear without hearing aids. It's funny how the deaf community is all about equality and ending discrimination. But they constantly segregate themselves from the general population with deaf schools, deaf sports teams, deaf clubs, sign language, without even learning to speak. Their anti-hearing devices attitude. And their awful exclusive attitude, "If you don't know sign, you don't exist to me." Ro, thank you for posting this. Back in 2000, the documentary Sound and Fury was released, and the issues it brought up have been haunting me ever since. It was my first introduction to deaf culture, and it was fascinating and a bit frightening. The film follows a young girl born to deaf parents who is eligible to receive a cochlear implant. The little girl is, like all children, profoundly curious and really wants to know what things sound like. She keeps bringing up that she wants to know how a car crash would sound. Her hearing grandparents are all for the implant. But her parents feel very strongly that such a thing would separate her from deaf culture. And that this would be unforgivable. An incredible amount of pressure is put on the family from the deaf community to deny the implant. Because deaf culture is too important to miss. Honestly, I was completely gobsmacked. Nobody seemed to think that a partially hearing girl who was being raised in deaf culture would be an asset. It was a highly emotional film. This is very interesting. I never knew about how the deaf community is. But I totally support your stand. People who like stories like this would probably also like the podcast Oh No. Ross and Carrie. In each episode, Ross and Carrie infiltrate a cult and then report on how weird it is. It's pretty interesting if you, like me, are fascinated by cults, creepy secretive groups. Have they infiltrated Amway yet? That it is so weird. While I'm not at all surprised, it is interesting to note that just about every cult mentioned in this thread is all about limiting the behavior of women. Well, these were pretty much run-of-the-mill conservative Southern Baptists. But I guess a lot of crazies aren't big fans of women that aren't barefoot and pregnant. Increasing the numbers. I went to a Landmark Forum presentation because a woman I knew, I'll call her Laura, went on and on about how much she loved it and how it had helped her. I should have suspected something was up because that was all she talked about. But I thought in my naivete that she was just really happy about what they were teaching her. The presentation was over the top dramatic, with people who were obviously planted in the audience standing up and stating how happy they were to be a part of Landmark. Some of them cried. It was unsettling to say the least. Even though I wanted to leave after I realized how staged and creepy the whole thing was. I sat through it all because I drove Laura and a couple of her friends there, so I couldn't just take off. At the end of the presentation, I was surrounded by Landmark representatives who kept asking me to sign up. But Laura was nowhere to be seen at this point. I guess she was letting the experts work me over. To be polite, I said things to these predators like I like to take my time to think things over before committing to them. They responded condescendingly, saying things like, "Well, how has your way of doing things worked for you so far? You're obviously here because your life isn't going as well as you would like. You need to change things or they will get worse." They kept pressuring me and I kept resisting. They were relentless. Finally got out of there and Laura started in on me, telling I should sign up. I smiled politely and said, "Yeah, maybe, but all I was thinking is after I drive her home, that will be the end of our relationship." Not that we were really friends. More like acquaintances. She was probably running out of friends if she was subjecting them all to this hit. Which I'm sure she was. Hopefully I can save one of you from a night like that. I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness. But my family were not as strict as yours seem. I got baptized at 22 but finally slipped away at the age of 28 when an elder told me on the eve of a big move from England to Ireland that it was easy to fall off the grid. Wink wink, nudge nudge. I quietly broke ties with the faith and made my life as I wanted it. My parents were a little upset when I finally told them. But my dad was most upset when I said I was an atheist and really had no faith in a higher power. I don't think he would have minded as much if I had left the faith but had some residual belief. Anyway, my relationship with family members who are still JW is fine. We just avoid the topic. I actually ignored all the advice regarding higher learning etc. So I had a great education, degree level, and a lot of scientific knowledge. I just didn't have the confidence to make the break until I got to that age and realized I was just fooling myself and making my life unhappy by following a faith I really had no interest in. Until that point, I actually tried to take it seriously and argued with people about faith and God from the standpoint of a creationist. I made arguments that I quietly demolished in my own head as I made them. Talk about cognitive dissonance. Edit. I admire your confidence though. I didn't want to embarrass my parents or make anyone unhappy. So I just slipped away. I didn't tell anyone except my parents, so as far as anyone cares, I'm just inactive. What happened to the quiverful lady? Came in to check up on the thread and now it is gone. Deleted. Does marching band count as a cult? Is mayonnaise a cult? Nah. Mayonnaise is more of an instrument. This will probably get buried in all the jokes and refuse that is Reddit. I don't know if I was born into a cult or we started when I was one. It doesn't really matter for me. At a very early age, my mom divorced my dad. And we were in this cult that beat the sin out of you. The ideology is simply put. We are all sinners with the devil in us and the only way to get him out is brute force. Preferably with a gang beating by the church elders. There would be days we had to stay at other people's homes when my mom was recovering from the beatings. When new members realized what was up, they'd go to the cops and the church would then move. When I was about 2, my mom kidnapped us kids from my dad and we ran away with the church. The church moved several times. And we with them. This continued until I was about 10. We changed my name 4 times during this period and I would sometimes go to more than one school per year. I'm now in my mid-40s. A recovered alcoholic. Successful at work. and in a relationship with a terrific woman. I only reached out and found my dad about a year ago. Which didn't go as well as you would hope. But hey. It's not Disney. It's real life. It's really sad how those type of crazies consider themselves Christians. What they do is incredibly unbiblical and makes the rest of us look bad. I dated a girl before whose parents had been in a cult. The Waco, Texas cult. They apparently got out shortly before the siege went down. Her dad was fairly level-headed. And I'm not sure why he was ever in a cult. Her mom was batshit ducking crazy. And I'm quite surprised that she's not in another cult now. Well. I haven't talked to any of them in years. She could have joined a new cult. I don't know who's going to see this at this point. TLDR. This past year in college I was gradually pulled into a cult at a vulnerable time in my life without being aware until I did some thorough research online. It's a Korean cult. Here it's called Providence. And it has a growing following here in the US. The leader used to be a Moony and claims that he is the real messiah, although no one in the group will mention this until you realize it yourself, and is in prison on rape charges. Jimscult.com link. Coming out of this I have serious trust issues and only a month ago finally completely broke off all contact with the group after I pulled the wool off my eyes in August and they continued to try and convince me to come back. I'll tell you the long part if you want. Commenting because I've always dreamed of running my own cult. And I'm now looking for ideas on the start. On a completely unrelated note. If you are feeling like you've been disillusioned by a cold and uncaring world. Maybe it's time you joined a family of like-minded individuals. A family that would appreciate it if you never left. Because it loves you so much. Also. There's pie. And it's delicious. But we don't let non-members have any. Sorry. Sign me up. I'd kill for some pie. Well then you're in for some fun. Thanks for watching and be sure to subscribe to Reddit Queen for the best daily content.